Who is Danny Rampling? Sitting right here with you today at this DMC interview. Where does he come from? London and somewhere out in the stars originally. But my DJ career started at a very young age through collecting records and loving music and listening to the radio. So that's where I come from, basically. That was the roots of my musical background, the medium of radio and vinyl, which led to this huge passion of collecting music and eventually going out there and sharing that music with the world through radio and club work. So basically that's where I come from, yeah, from that love and that core passion of enjoying music and wanting, you know, that wanting desire to share that with people. How did I first get touched by music? Listening to the radio. My mother would always have the radio on in the house, and as a young kid, it started out with those stations. And I was fascinated how the music was transmitted through the radio. I was absolutely fascinated by that. So that was at a very young age. And then that led to me having a dream of becoming a radio presenter by listening to pirate radio stations. Radio Luxembourg was a pirate radio station at the time. And it also, you know, kind of listening late at night when I should have been sleeping on a, you know, a small transistor radio, having this like imagination that, God, you know, where's this music broadcast? It must be a great life out there on the sea, you know, far away from the land, just playing music night and day to an invisible audience as such. And I thought, that sounds like a really glamorous job to have. Well, it's not a job, it's a lifestyle. But at the time as a kid, it was like, God, I'd love to do that. And then, you know, kind of years later, that dream became a reality. But that's really where it began, that fascination for radio, listening to the radio until the early hours of the morning till I fell asleep, particularly Radio Luxembourg. I even used to listen to Tony Prince on the radio. The rhythm
of nightlife in Great Britain. Hey, good evening, everybody. This is your royal ruler, Tony Prince. Radio
Luxembourg. Emperor Roscoe. Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready to party? The Emperor Roscoe. So, you know, kind of showing my age a bit, but those are the early roots of radio for me as well. And I had this big dream that one day I'd love to be a DJ on radio. I had that at a very young age, a very, very young age, probably about, you know, kind of 10 years old, really. Right, giving you the bridge of how I actually did get onto a radio station. Being an avid record collector, I worked with DJs as their assistants in the early days, just to get a foot in the door with people like Nicky Holloway, for example. I was his assistant for many years, and he introduced me to a lot of key people in the industry at the time. And one of those people was Gordon Mack, who founded Kiss FM. And Gordon had a show on, I think it was Solar or one of those channels, one of those pirates at the time. And he used to have this afternoon slot where members of the public would send in their top three. And I sent in a top three, my top three tracks. He loved them. And that got me an introduction to Gordon. And he was, shortly after that, he set up Kiss Radio. Now, I kept in touch with Gordon. And Gordon Mack was very instrumental in my career in radio. He gave me that break, that initial break, that there wasn't an opening until I met Gordon Mack. And I think it was a real lucky break, though, just for the fact that I had sent in that top three to that radio station, took time out to do that. He actually liked the selection, and he saw something in that. You know, he heard something there he liked. One of them was Ripple, The Beat Goes On. I think the other one may have been Leon Ware, That's Why I Came to California. But going back to what were the first records I bought, well, the first records that I bought were T-Rex, you know, those glam artists, David Bowie, that kind of sound at the time, you know, even Gary Glitter, the Glitter Band, all of those bands, you know, those 70s bands, I was really, you know, influenced by them, and Tamla Motown, that side of it, the soul music. I had a cousin who, she'd been a, you know, a hippie in the 60s period, and that was, she was very inspiring to me as well. And a kid who lived down the road who had a mobile DJ set up, who was playing in a working man's club at 13 years old, had the big, you know, unit, the console, the flashing lights, and I used to model him, really. I dreamed to be him, but didn't have the actual kind of, at the time, the know-how and the confidence to do what he was doing at 13 years old. But actually, on the subject of first records as well, I found this at home earlier. I don't know, this is like, you know, I got conned with this, and I don't know how I came across this earlier. I walked past the record shop as a kid. I thought, that looks like a good deal. It's got all these original artists on it, so the cover says, but unbeknown to me. I took that home and it was they're all cover versions. So it's not an original album. I thought that was tremendous value at the time. All of my kind of idols, you know, kind of Slade, Sweet, all of these people, T-Rex, and got it home. But I've always kept that. It's a reminder of, like, you know, that was the first album I bought, actually. I didn't get conned again after that. But I think most kids got, like, kind of led into this, like, false promise of this cheaply priced album with all of these hits on it by the original artist, but sung by cover band. So there you go. That, I believe, was my first album. Okay, what took me away from my early roots of, like, T-Rex and all those bands? Buying disco 12-inch records, and then punk came along. I used to go to a lot of live gigs, and then on from punk, got back into soul, into Northern Soul, into soul music, into hip hop, and then that progression into house music. How did I meet Nicky Holloway, who was a leading DJ on the London scene back then, at that period in the early 80s? He was hosting events in clubs and bars, and putting one-offs on, and I met him in Ibiza in the early 80s, in bars every night, on the dance floor, dancing, chasing women, having a great time generally, and we clicked. And then when we got back to London, we became very, very good friends. It was the early days of my aspirations of wanting to become a DJ. I had some basic bar work, but I wanted to play in clubs, basically, and play on these cooler parties. So I never ever got that break with Nicky, but what he did unwittingly do was taught me just about everything I needed to know about DJing and promotions, because I used to help him promote his events, the Special Branch and the Do's at the Zoo and all of these events. And Nicky was, you know, quite happy with me working with him, because obviously I was a good worker, I was a great assistant to him. I used to carry his boxes to clubs to get a foot through the door there and meet promoters. And I think that was a really good training period, looking back on it. Long before the days of The Secret and The Law of Attraction, I knew that's what I wanted, and I got close to the source. We became friends for a very good reason. I got close to the source, and I later modeled what he was doing by, you know, putting on my own events. So it was a great time. I got introduced to lots of people in the industry. I went to, you know, all of the best parties. I helped him set up all of his events. I helped him promote those events. And I learned a great deal over probably about a four to five year period working with him. I met Nicky Holloway in Ibiza in the early 80s. And then years later, we went back to Ibiza with Paul Oakenfold. It was his birthday. Johnny Walker, who was working at, I believe, Polydor Records at the time, on this trip that changed all of our lives and many people in dance music. We got out there, we knew what we were looking for. We had friends over there who'd been there the whole season, particularly Trevor Fung, who was very instrumental in introducing us to Amnesia, where DJ Alfredo, the legendary Ibizan DJ, who was playing in this open air club. Real cosmopolitan crowd of people, and kind of introduced to some other kind of, you know, nighttime goodies, and that was it. You know, the stage was set, and we heard all this incredible music fused together, and that's where the whole term Balearic Beats comes from, because Alfredo would start with, you know, funk, hip-hop, Latin, pop, rock, indie, and then move into house music, you know, electronic, house, techno. It was just an amazing mixture of music that he weaved together. Like, I've always said he was the Larry Levan of Europe to me, through my eyes. Just the way he created texture with music, and how he had so much flair of playing so many different genres together. You know, we'd all come from a specific background of you know, kind of hip hop, soul music, disco, specialized really. I hadn't been through indie rock and pop, and wasn't acquainted with that music. I was into soul music, funk, rare groove. That was my sound. Same for Nicky as well. So hearing all this indie stuff, I was like, God, this music's brilliant, isn't it? And all of that being played together in the open air was a life-changing experience for all of us. And I think, you know, experiencing that, that was when my DJ career became professional, because that gave me the inspiration to return to London. It gave all of us a great deal of inspiration, but it gave me a great deal of inspiration to start my own club night. And that's where Shume began. I'd played at an engagement party in this fitness centre venue in southeast London by Southwark Bridge, and I knew one day that was going to be the club, that would be the club that I would create and play to an audience. I visualised that years before, knowing that one day I'm going to come back here, I'm going to play to an audience that appreciates music. Had all this experience in Ibiza and thought, let's take some of this experience and merge it with an experience in London. Take some of that Ibiza magic and sprinkle some of that magic Ibiza dust into a London club environment, an underground club space. It was a basement, it held 300 people, and within weeks it had really become the blueprint for the scene and the rave scene, alongside Paul's club at he was doing Future at the time, then it was Land of Oz and Spectrum, and Nicky was doing, he went on to start the Trip. Nicky came back and was still doing the Special Branch events and incorporating house into them, but the crowd weren't quite ready for it. But then within like 3 or 4 months, that crowd that was into Rare Groove and the soul stuff, most of that crowd had then migrated over to the house sound, and it was an incredible shift in musical taste and direction and BPMs. The music was faster than what it had been for many years, and this whole thing, it was a revolution was sparked. It was an incredible time to be at the forefront of that as well, very fortunate. But we all came back so greatly inspired and all did things our own way. We all contributed greatly in our own way and our own styles. How did I promote Shume? With a hell of a lot of enthusiasm, that's for sure. A bucket load of enthusiasm. I knew, I had a knowing feeling in every cell in my body that this was my time now to become a DJ. I'd learnt my craft by, you know, kind of struggling for many years, not getting the openings, but keeping on with it. I kept on with it. I kept close to Nicky Holloway. I kept on with my motivation and my ambitions to become a DJ, and that was set in Ibiza that night. So shortly after I came back, I was working in a bar in southeast London where I met my wife at the time, Jenny. And Jenny was very instrumental in creating Shume. We created it together. I borrowed some money off a family member. I think it was about 300 quid. Went back to the basement owner, said, we want to come here and do a club night. Said, yeah, sure thing. And that first night I co-promoted with a Rare Groove promoter, a guy called Ian. And it didn't work out. There were two crowds. There was the Rare Groove crowd, and there was this kind of amnesia, kind of Ibiza, kind of hippie-ish, kind of acid house crowd. And the crowds didn't go too well together. They danced to their music and our crowd danced to the house sound. So we had a wreath that first night. We came away from it. We didn't make any money. I think we just about broke even. It was £5 to get in. And then we had a rethink. And then a month later, I think it was in November, we called it Shume, spelt with a C. So what we did, we went out and we flyered London. We got hundreds of flyers, thousands of flyers. We walked the streets, we went to the art colleges, we went to all of the stores, Kensington Market, record shops, anywhere we could distribute flyers. We went to a couple of the London gay clubs, to Pyramid and Jungle at the time, because there was a great DJ, Colin Favour and Mark Moore playing there, who later came on to play at Shume. The music was great there, they were playing house music, so we targeted that crowd as well. We flyered everywhere, we walked the streets, we was out all the time, and that's really how it began. And then the whole thing, it snowballed so quickly through word of mouth. Something's going on here, and it's something very unusual, and this is really groundbreaking what's going on here. You know, a basement lit with strobes, blacked out with banners with smiley faces on, and smoke, constant smoke. You could never see in there. People had thought they'd left the planet and gone somewhere else most of the time they were in there. And a booming sound system. Carl Cox, he put in the first sound system, and Carl came and played. He was actually on the first Shume, Carl. So he went off and started his own thing as well. He was working with Paul Oakenfold at the time. And Carl went off and became, you know, the three-deck king of the rave scene, you know, playing to hundreds of thousands of people at raves. Let's just talk about the wave that followed Shume and where my career progressed to. But you know, when we came back from Ibiza, all four of us, Paul Oakenfold already had a larger amount of experience in the music business, you know, working with Rush Release promotion companies, Def Mix Records. He was promoting events in London at the Project Club in Streatham and other places in Covent Garden. So he had experience in events promotion, and Nicky as well had a huge amount of experience behind him. I was a newbie on the block, but what set me apart was a great deal of fresh enthusiasm. We all had enthusiasm, but it was the fact that I got an opportunity to create something for myself now. And I think that's really why Shume became so popular, was my own spirit. I'd been in America the year before that, out of the UK. I nearly lost my life in a car crash, which completely changed my life and the way I was thinking and everything. My lifestyle, just my zest for life had gone through the roof. You know, I was just grateful to be alive. And I think that really kind of transcended into the people that were in the club. Shume was a family thing, and people are still friends today. It was all about friendship, unity, peace, love, and that was the ethos behind the club. It wasn't just about playing the latest house music sounds and, you know, acid house, like, you know, kind of all the great clubs, the Paradise Garage. It was a family affair, you know, the Blitz in London, Taboo. All of the great clubs have been like a family, a core group of people. And that's really what Shume was. And, you know, everyone I talk to this day, people have been friends since, you know, that emerged in 87, 88. They're still great friends today. So many great friendships were born out of that room, and so many great businesses as well. It gave a lot of people opportunity. The whole scene opened up this whole wave of opportunity. You know, we had a very, very difficult political climate here pre-Acid House, lack of youth opportunities, unemployment was at an all-time high, and then all of a sudden Acid House arrived and it opened up this whole cottage industry. You know, people were creating a business for themselves, they were creating career paths, and that was the power of this whole new music that had arrived, opened up this whole new wave of opportunity, and many doors were open for people that were closed firmly before Acid House arrived, which actually fueled the British music industry. It opened up so many opportunities within production, within record labels, within sales of music, within marketing, within design, production, artists, all of this exploded. And it also, it boomed the economy. The economy started to boom within music. It was boom time. You know, on one hand, people were having their houses repossessed, and then this whole scene had emerged where people were not related to that at all and having the time of their lives. And there was money. People had some money in their pocket. They were going out every night. They were experiencing something that was so unusual and unique at the time. And there was this whole wave like there was in the 60s. Now, there was a guy called Roger, who was an original 60s hippie, that came down to Shume and said, "This is just like the happenings we used to go to in the 60s. So I guess we've captured a bit of that spirit and the ethos of that. And that legacy was continuing through Acid House in certain quarters. Shume lasted from 87 till at the end of 89, just early 90. The rave scene emerged out of the whole Acid House movement, which, you know, you'd have up to 100,000 people at some raves. That's where the real kind of, you know, volume, superstar DJ, big fees, that was the foundations of it, the rave scene. I didn't really get involved with the rave scene a great deal because I found there was too much of a criminal element involved. There was a lot of dodginess going on, and it had become overrun by too much excess. It had become ugly. So Shume went on, we left Shume, we stopped it. I think by then we'd had enough. We wanted to change the scene. And we started a club called Pure, where everything had become pure again. And it was, you know, people started to dress up again. So Pure actually inspired clubs like Vague and James Bailey at Venus in Nottingham, and Cream. And that's really where the whole super club thing started to emerge. the Ministry of Sound, yes, of course, in London, was the first super club outside of the Hacienda. But the Hacienda wasn't a super club as such. It was a cool underground club. The Ministry came straight on the map and landed itself as the first official super club. That was its identity, which, of course, inspired Cream to become the North of England's big super club. And I think that was an incredible time as well, because that happened, you know, in the early part of the 90s, say 92, 93. That's when that really started to take shape. And then throughout the whole course of the 90s, it gave so many DJs an opportunity to have a bigger platform for themselves. It gave me the opportunity to progress from early days of Kiss Pirate Radio to Kiss going legal, hosting a Saturday night show for a number of years, and then being approached by Radio One. My radio career had gone, you know, from the small beginnings of pirate radio to the top of the tree at Radio One, where I stayed for 7 years. And as a result of that radio show and Pete Tong's radio show and other radio shows, they were fueling the scene in the UK. Everyone was going out on a Friday, Saturday night. People were driving 200-300 miles up, you know, up and down the country each weekend to go to Cream, to go to Venus, to go to Renaissance, all of the clubs, you know, Shindig, all these clubs. And everyone was having a great time. It was a real boom period. That whole acid house wave led to that secondary wave where the whole scene had become far more professional and far more business driven, which carved out great careers for many people in the industry on the business side of it. I still am a great radio DJ. Radio One was a great experience. I was there for 7 years. I was brought into Radio One through Pete Tong and Jeff Young, and that was at the time when Matthew Bannister became station controller. And I've never really spoken about this in detail. It's been mentioned in a book, but I basically became the fall guy. I was taken out, which was the worst move that they could have made at the time. And some of the people that were involved in that now recognise what happened and know that they actually did wrong, because I was helping a lot of labels, create a healthy business, helping artists carve out careers, helping record stores sell music, and you know, on that end of the specialised end of that of the dance scene, and labels were flourishing and being supported with that platform on the radio. But unfortunately, some people had other ideas, and I got axed from Radio One. I had no idea it was coming, and I was taken out of there within a week. I was given no notice, and I think, looking back on it, I was very unfairly dismissed from there for no good reason. This was all through internal politics and industry insecurities around my position and management that I was involved with at the time, and other management companies. And I was also not paid for 6 months of radio shows to add insult to injury. So really, you know, kind of, it was a very upsetting time. It was something that, it's taken me years to get over that. You know, I thought I was presenting a great radio show, people loved it, but I wasn't playing the corporate game enough at the BBC. And that's a great lesson I learned from that experience. So, you know, out of that negative, a lot of positive experiences, you know, have helped me with my own business career, for example, have come out of that negative experience. It was a real kick in the teeth. But, you know, I'm now way beyond that. I can admit to what happened. People were like, why did he leave? What went on there? People just didn't know about what actually went on behind the scenes. And that's basically what happened, you know. I got axed out of there, I was pushed out of there, I was replaced by DJs who didn't really want to be there and take that slot because they didn't have the radio experience, and they were in a difficult position being managed by other management companies. And you know, bless them, they didn't have the experience. I had 20 years of radio experience presenting radio shows. And Matthew Bannister axed Simon Bates and all of the old Radio 1 DJs, which must have been very disappointing for all those guys, and replaced with a whole new wave of specialist shows and daytime presenters, which, you know, Chris Malls and everybody else was brought onto the station. And it totally transformed the look and feel of Radio 1. I lasted there 7 years. I don't think it was anything to do with ages, and my listening figures were very, very solid. They were increasing, they weren't decreasing. It baffles me to this day, but I understand what it was about. I can be forgiving to a certain degree, but the way it was managed was just absolutely appalling, quite frankly. Absolutely appalling. And I think, you know, as that experience unfolded, It took me a long while to get over it and actually didn't want to go back to radio. And I felt disowned by the scene. I felt let down by a lot of people and I couldn't trust many people around me. And I will say that's what led, that really underpinned kind of me taking a break from the from what I do and what I love best, DJing, for a good couple of years. I wasn't over that Radio 1 thing. I wasn't. It led to a lot of confusion. It limited my beliefs in myself and my career. I'd lost my direction. I didn't know who to trust. All of those things combined, I think, actually contributed to me taking an exit from the scene itself. I had a bit of a midlife. I had, so to speak. I was in my kind of like, I was 43 or something, and I was getting restless. It was like, I'd been on the road for many years, having a great time and doing what I love. And then my wife and I at the time, we had a son, and everything was changing, and my thought process was changing. My whole mindset was changing. I was getting tired of being on the road. I was disillusioned by what had gone on a couple of years before that. I kind of wasn't feeling the music so much either, I have to admit that. And I'd actually kind of lost sight of my creativity and my inspiration. And I think many artists go through that, particularly in music. You have your highs and lows, but some people can just push on relentlessly and just, play music for the sake of it and sometimes not even be enjoying that music. But, I'm true to the music. I wasn't totally enjoying the music. The music direction had changed. I was changing as a man. I got into this period of unrest in my 40s. It was I got very restless. So I went off and spent 2 years kind of developing other business. I wrote a book, which, I think if I hadn't have taken a break from the scene, this book would not have been produced. So with two business partners, Ben Brophy and Jerry Frempong, we attended an internet marketing business seminar, a free seminar in Hammersmith, and there was a talk on ebooks, and ebooks were relatively unknown in the UK at the time. They weren't really in the public domain, big in America. So we sat down, we said, let's go off and write an ebook about DJing, and that's how this hard copy began. So we spent 6 months researching and writing up this ebook, and then we put it out online. We made great sales worldwide, and a publisher saw the ebook and said, well, actually, we really like the look of your book and what you're presenting here. And then a year later on from that, it turned into this hard copy book, 330 pages, DVD in the back, which took a month to produce. There's, interviews there with Pete Tong, Joey Negro, David Morales, Simon Dunmore, Mark Marotte, who managed Oakenfold and U2. This whole book has been 3 years in the making. So I'm very proud of the fact that, I took that break and came out the other side of it with this, which is also putting something back into the industry, back into music, back into the passion, and helping others get to their level where they want to be with their career. What are my views on British music? I think British music at the moment is very, very exciting. New bands emerging, new electronic artists. Within dance, the French have led the way in recent times and still do. The Swedes are leading the way. The British have always been out there flying the flag for British music. But I feel that I think we're getting very closer to that point of, the Brits have arrived again. The Brits are back in town. Now, we're always there. We're always doing it. We're always leading the way with cutting edge music. Always creating new sounds, new genres, new artists, and the world looks to Britain for its musical taste, its direction, the artists that we produce, the music we produce generally. And I think that focus is coming back upon British music, particularly having the Olympics here this year as well. Is we're under the spotlight here on the global stage, and as a result of that, I think I feel that that will also help with the whole of the British music scene worldwide. What are my views on Simon Cowell? I think he's a very smart man. I think he's maybe he's helped some people with their careers. He's broken a lot of hearts, that's for sure. A lot of people's kind of ambitions, but some people have to have a reality check. I have to say, I've probably seen the X Factor once. It's not my it's not something that I would enjoy watching, you know, so to speak. I don't watch television. I'm too busy doing other things and enjoying my life. But I think it has been detrimental to the British music scene as well by creating this wave of manufactured artists that has totally watered down music when there is so much great raw talent out there that hasn't really had a look in, because this whole machine has practically single-handedly taken over the British music scene, really. And then it has an effect on all the other labels, you know, having to create artists that fit that kind of mould. And I think it has impacted the British music industry, but there's a backlash, you know, not wanting that for one minute. You know, he's a very successful guy, he's a smart guy, and he's done a lot of things for commercial careers, created, you know, opportunities for people who want to go down that commercial route of music and want to have that as a career path. But on the other hand, you know, a lot of people have missed out, and they've been pushed off of radio playlists, they haven't been able to get their music heard through radio and get onto labels, and I think that's changing now. It's changing again, you know. People have so much of a certain genre or certain approach to music, and well, I certainly feel we're at the cusp of change. There's so much raw, great talent out there, and we need more of that on television. We need more of that raw talent exposed on television. This whole DJ contest thing he's doing on television, I'm kind of on the fence with it. I think it's a great thing for the DJ industry. I do think so, because it's taken years for DJs for the role of a DJ to be taken seriously as a career opportunity. People want to be DJs, you know, they want to be like David Guetta or myself or whoever, you know, kind of Carl Cox or Paul Oakenfold. They want to be and aspire to be that kind of DJ. I feel that there will be DJs that enter those contests on TV that have been DJing for years and struggling and not had their breaks, and they may therefore get a break through that television programme. So I think that's a positive thing in itself, because there are some DJs out there on the circuit that have been doing it for like 10, 15 years and they haven't had the luck or the break or the opportunity or the skills or, you know, the association with certain people to get to where they really truly aspire and desire to be. So I think, you know, it may well help that those quarters of the DJ community. And also what it will do, it's probably likely to like create a wave of manufactured DJs, but then, you know, kind of there's a place for those DJs as well. And, you know, we go to clubs and festivals where we, you know, we go for certain DJs or certain musical genres, so yeah, there'll be a place for those DJs to play as well, you know, in the commercial end of the club scene. And I think that will also help the commercial club business, you know, kind of like the big commercial chains. They've suffered in this recession as well. You know, club attendances are down, whether it's an underground club or a commercial a group operator. So I feel that it could do a lot of good for the nightclub industry. At present, within music, I'm greatly inspired. I have a tremendous amount of gratitude for what I do. As I said, I took a break, I came back, I've spent three years now redeveloping my career, repositioning myself, and I'm greatly inspired at present, and at last I'm going to produce an album. I have a great conceptual idea. I'm working with my fiance. She's a DJ of 12 years, she's from the US. And we're writing an album together with a great writing team here in the UK. And our aim is to create that hit album that I've always aspired and longed to actually produce. In fact, I'm as inspired now as much as when I began. You know, in 87, when I began Shoom and Acid House emerged, I feel that level of inspiration and creativity for what I'm doing. Bring it back to the present, a 25th anniversary to commemorate Shoom. Never really wanted to revisit, and it's not a reunion as such, it's more of a celebration of the culture that we've contributed to, dance music, electronic music, the whole scene. So we're going to host a warehouse party in London. It was going to be on June the 2nd, but we had a few venue issues and we are moving that date to probably October and November of this year. So it gives us a longer lead time. Probably about 2,000 people at this event. Hopefully some of the artists that have contributed, a number of the DJs that were there at the beginning, along with established DJs of the present and future DJs. So it's combining all of the elements of the scene itself. Very excited about that. 25th anniversary. It's, you know, here we are 25 years later celebrating this major milestone in club culture, and that will be in October. In probably we're certainly aiming at Southeast London venue. Okay, what are my tips and advice to somebody who's like young and really wants to become a DJ? Well, it can be a fast track for some, and they are one in a million. You know, kind of, there are some people that just burst onto the scene and all of a sudden, you know, they're at the top of the list. I think production is very important, is learning how to produce music. That is key to the role of the DJ now. And don't expect the doors to open immediately. You could be the best DJ in the world. And let's not forget, people like David Guetta have spent many years. He hasn't just become an overnight sensation filling stadiums. He's worked for like 15 years as a DJ in Paris and around the world. It's about having burning ambition, passion, drive, dedication, commitment, and ambition. And not giving up when the going gets tough, because it does get tough. Whatever level you're at, whether you're coming into the industry for, you know, kind of the early days of it, or whether you're at the top of the tree in the industry, you know, there are good days and bad days, but it's, you know, it's taking the knockbacks and getting on with it and moving on, but just being so committed to what you do. And it is about having a strong passion for music. It's not about coming into the scene and saying, well, look, I'm going to be David Guetta and all I want to do is make loads and loads of money. Because actually, maybe a few of those people succeed, but generally they fall by the wayside and then they move on to something else. The core driver is music. If you love music, you want to share that with people. It's about, you know, trying any angle you can, you know, getting close to people that work in and they're established in the industry, whether they be DJs or promoters or managers. You know, it's turning up, it's being present, it's going to a club, you know, your local club, getting in that club, your face becomes known, you know. And people say, well, it's no good, I hand out mixed CDs and this, that, and they don't get listened to. But if you're persistent, subtle persistent, and it's getting close to people, working with those people, working for free with people, asking them, you know, kind of, can I come and work in your studio? You know, can I drive you? Can I, you know, can I come out on the road with you and help you on the road? You know, a lot of people don't have people asking them, you know, and there's one out of 100 you may well get lucky with. Well, actually, I'm looking for a driver. You know, I know people who've started out driving people who've become great DJs and producers, for example. I've known people that have worked behind the bar in the club just to have an in that club and have become great DJs. So it's like, you know, if you can't go straight to the source and get in there and become a DJ immediately, it's like, how can we try and angle in through a different direction? Whether it be working in the bar, whether it be working in the office, whatever it may be, and then soon enough, you are going to get noticed. Some things in life, like most things are, that are great, are well worth the wait.